I'd like you to take your Bibles, if you would, and turn to the third chapter of Colossians. I'll share just a few things with you from this text. We're going to be talking about restoring relationships at work. And it came to my mind that most of us spend more of our waking hours working than doing anything else. As I thought about that leading up to this, I wondered if we spend some of our sleeping hours at work, but I don't know if that could come out right or not, probably not. But anyway, we spend more of our waking hours at work than doing anything else that we do, and that makes it pretty important. Some of us have jobs we love, can't wait to get back there. Some of us have jobs that we could live forever and never go back if we could get the money some other way. But, you know, work is pretty important to us. And God tells us, I think he cares about our lives. I don't know if that has dawned on you yet, but God cares about our lives. And when a big portion of our lives is our work, he certainly cares about that. And the scripture we're going to look today relates to that topic. But it is kind of by way of application. We're going to read a text, and it talks about slaves and masters. And the whole issue, I don't know if you're aware of what people are saying in our culture today, but the whole issue of what the Bible says about slavery is kind of a black eye to the church, to Christianity, because the Bible does not come right out and say, slavery is wrong, we've got to quit that whole institution. There's no verse you can point to that says that. And, you know, we could wish that we could do that. You know, I remember years ago they used to talk about, in the South, the peculiar institution of slavery. And some people even use the Bible to justify slavery. I've seen videos of Klan meetings where they use the Bible to justify racism and all those things. Just because the Bible gets used incorrectly does not mean we should criticize God when sinful people distort a good book to make it say something that it's not saying. If we were to walk down the streets in the Roman Empire, In a typical city in Rome, probably between one-third and one-half of the people that we would meet would have been slaves. That was the culture that the Bible was written in. Had they written out and said, you know, this is a terrible institution, we need to free all the slaves and change this immediately, can you imagine the response that the world would have given to that? It would have been completely rejected without ever having heard. Who would have imagined a world without slaves? It's almost like when I was a kid, imagining a teacher's room where you open the door and the blue smoke didn't blow out. You couldn't imagine that the world would change, that public places wouldn't have smoking. You couldn't imagine that when I was a kid. But here it is. It's changed. The Bible laid a foundation. Bible laid a foundation that eventually led to the dissolution, at least the illegality of slavery. A couple of things that the Bible has in it that eventually led to that. First of all, the view of mankind. It's hard to hold the view of mankind that every man, woman, and child is created in the image of God, as the Bible teaches, and think that someone should own another person or restrict their freedom like that. So the view of mankind, all created in the image of God, that eventually got rid of slavery. That in the church, there was neither slave nor free. Galatians 3, 26 to 28 says, you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus, for all of you were baptized into who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And so we have, even in the early church, somebody with a slave name, Onesimus. The slave that's recounted in the book of Philemon. But a different Onesimus was given a huge burial as if he were a wealthy man, but he had a slave name. And the conjecture is probably he was a leader in the church, maybe an elder or a bishop or something, and was given this burial because of the love of the people for him. So in the church, neither slave nor free, and so that in this culture, in this subculture, it didn't matter if you came to church as a slave or as a master. In the church, you had a totally different identity, your identity in Christ. And then the third thing that I think the Bible did was it talked about the attitudes of people's heart. Even in a culture where there was slavery, Paul again in 1 Corinthians 7, 20 to 24, talks about their situation, but says, you know, in your heart, you can be free. He says, each one should remain in the situation which he was called in, or which each one should remain in the situation which he was in when God called him. Were you a slave when you were called? Don't let it trouble you. Although if you can get your freedom, do so. For he who was a slave when he was called by the Lord is the Lord's freedman. Similarly, he who was a free man when he was called is Christ's slave. So all these things eventually led to the forbidding of slavery in England under Wilberforce, and then here in America after the Civil War. And some of these things were biblical principles that eventually led to that. But yet the Bible was written in a world in which slavery was practiced, although there were restrictions on it. The scripture we read today will be those restrictions on slavery. But I think we can apply this to work because it's the situation we find ourselves in. Some of these principles certainly apply to our workaday world. I'm going to read Colossians chapter 3, 22 to 4, chapter 4, verse 1. If you could follow along. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything. And do it not only when their eye is on you and to win their favor, but with sincerity of heart and reverence for the Lord. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men. Since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Anyone who does wrong will be repaid for his wrong, and there is no favoritism. Masters, provide your slaves with what is right and fair, because you know that you also have a master in heaven. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, we thank you for your grace and for your freedom that is found in you. Thank you that we have a Savior who saved us from bondage to sin and delivered us. We thank you also that you care about our lives. We don't face any trouble, but that you don't care about that. You do care about all those things. We are not in any temptation that you haven't, Jesus, that you haven't faced and come away from victoriously. So Lord, we pray that in our workaday world, you'll help us to live as your servants. You are our King. You are our God. Ultimately, you're our boss, and so we pray that we might please you in everything we say, everything we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, last week or 2 weeks ago, I preached on the message of restoring relationships at home. This title of this sermon is Restoring Relationships at Work. For us, those are two different things. But in the time when this was written, that was really one and the same thing. In fact, slaves were considered part of the household of their masters. And so for them, If they looked at the wives, submit to your husbands, husbands, love your wives, children, obey your parents, fathers, don't embitter your children, and saw then slaves, obey your masters, and masters, provide with what's right and fair. If they saw that, they would have pictured entirely the context of the home. They wouldn't be separating this out the way we are. And yet for most of us, we work outside of our homes. But for them, it came as part of the household rules. They would have seen that as part of the same thing. We're going to primarily talk about application today. The rule for the house is for the workers, there's really only one command here, and that is to obey your earthly masters in everything. So for the workers, obey your boss. The number one complaint of both employers and employees is that the other person doesn't listen to them. Number one complaint, they never listen to me. For the employers, they mean, when I tell my employees what to do, they don't do it. For the employees, what they mean is, I've got all these great ideas of how to make this work better. And we try to share them, and they don't listen. They don't take our insight into perspective. Sound familiar, doesn't it? I can see some heads smiling and thinking, yeah. In each case, and kind of the unique thing about the Bible is there is a reciprocal relationship, a relationship that cares about the other person's perspective. That's taught here in the Bible. I don't think you would have seen this in some other lecture by some secular teacher in the Roman world. It would have been for the, you know, slaves, obey, masters, if they don't obey, just beat them. Have you seen that very humorous sign that says the beatings will continue until morale improves? What a riot. Think about that later. All right. But here the issue is, the one command for workers is that we obey those who are over us. Now, there's some background to it. I love the way God doesn't just tell you to do something most of the time. He gives you some background, some understanding, some either details or explanations or motivations and things. He continues to say, to serve with sincerity of heart. And that would be my first point today. For workers, be sincere. How many times have you heard somebody say, better look busy, the boss is coming? Have you heard that? That could have been taken right out of that verse. He says, obey your earthly masters in everything you do, and do it not only when their eye is on you and to win their favor, but do it with sincerity. So if it's, oh, the boss is coming, better look busy, that's not sincere, is it? That's not working from your heart. And it's not, and he says, you know, be sincere. Don't just do it to please the master. I want to look good in front of the boss. It, in a way, that's the assumption. The assumption is workers are going to toe the line when the boss is looking. And they're going to want to make their boss happy. That's kind of the assumption. The other part of the assumption is when they're not looking, you're not going to worry about it. And when they might not find out about it, you don't really care about pleasing the boss. That's the unwritten text that we can kind of gather from our lives that we've led so far. But what God wants us to do is to be sincere. Do this, work hard, obey your masters with sincerity of heart, so that even if the boss will never find out, or you know they're not showing up that afternoon, you still do your job because of the sincerity of your heart. And where that comes from is to recognize, really, that you work for God. Listen to this. Whatever you do, verse 23, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men. Since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Now, he said about three times, you don't work for your boss, you work for the Lord. I think when he repeats things over and over again, he wants us to get the point. Ultimately, you don't work for your boss, you work for the Lord. I don't even know how I got this, but I have a little briefcase that says, I love my job, and the other side says, I hate my boss. I've never had a chance to use that. It might say the other way. It might say, I love my boss and I hate my job. It does, in a way, it doesn't really matter. But like I said, I don't even know how I ever came into possession of it. In fact, I may have thrown it away. But there's that tension between the reality of what you face every day, maybe, and what we know we ought to have. We ought to have a respect for our boss. We ought to have a respect for our job. But recognize, and one thing that might help you in this, is if you have a difficult boss, and I've known professional people, PhDs, who at work every day, their boss would scream and swear profanities at them. That'd be tough to take. That would be really tough to take. So you may have a difficult boss like that. If you do, take comfort in the fact that you don't work for your boss, you work for God. Now, you can change jobs. That's the other thing you can do. If it's that miserable, you can start looking. We have an advantage over the church in the first century in that if we were slaves in the first century, you wouldn't have an option to change jobs. But we're here in the 21st century, and we do have the option of changing jobs. That would be a choice. But if you're in a job you like and you just have an annoying person that's over you right now, and you want to stick it out, be comforted in the fact that you don't work for that person, you work ultimately for God. Now, for many of you, it's probably easy for you to recognize that I work for God. I'm in the Lord's work. I'm a pastor, so he's doing the Lord's work. But this verse says that even slaves, in doing menial work in the first century, that even they worked for God. So is it hard to imagine that you also work for God ultimately, whatever you do? That you're doing kingdom work, that essentially one of the things that we can do in our minds is figure out how is what I'm doing ultimately contributing to the world. In other words, say you're a plumber. Does God want the pipes fixed? Yeah, he does. Wouldn't it be good that pipes worked and people turned on water? And it was helped people to have water available to them. Or a teacher. Does God want people to understand the world that we live in and to relate to it? Yeah, sure. If you think about your job and you can't figure out how God might bless that as part of his kingdom work, send me an email and I'll work with you and we'll say, well, how can this work for good? How does this help make the world a better place? I'll help you do that. If you send me an email, I will do that. If your job is something that doesn't make the world a better place in some way, that you can't imagine God wanting that, say you run a casino, or something like that, email me that. I'll try to send you like the want ads of some other thing to do. Help you find another job, something that God can bless, something that does fit into his kingdom work. When we recognize that we work for God, we can see in here that ultimately Jesus is our boss. So like Jesus is our supervisor. Think about that. Jesus is our supervisor. We don't just work when the boss is coming down the hall, but we work when our supervisor's watching us. When does Jesus watch us at work? All the time, right? So whether our boss sees it or not, the Lord sees it. So he's our supervisor. He ultimately is our paycheck signer. Like in this world now, he provides for our needs in different ways, and he is our provider. We should never look at work as if that's what's providing us, or our boss as if they are our provider. Ultimately, it's God who's our provider. And ultimately, he's going to pay us even later. It says here in verse 23 that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. Now, if you were a first century slave and you got paid nothing, wouldn't it be encouraging to know that God someday is going to pay you for your faithfulness when you leave this world? I think that would be very encouraging. So ultimately, recognize Jesus is our boss. He's our supervisor. And I want you to remember who Jesus is when you think about that. He is King of the universe, but didn't we just sing a song about how the King of the universe died for us? He loves us that much. He cares about us. So if your boss doesn't care about you, think about that other boss you have who does care about you and who wants your whole life to be something that is praiseworthy. One more phrase about this. In this book of Colossians, he says there's no favoritism with the Lord. Verse 25, anyone who does wrong will be repaid for his wrong, and there is no favoritism. In Colossians, that verse is directed, or that idea that there's no favoritism is directed to the servants, the workers. Over in Ephesians, the idea of God not having favorites is directed to the bosses or the masters. But it's true, anything. You know, there's favoritism you can do in favor of the worker. There's favoritism in favor of the employer. There's none of that with God. He looks at everybody the same and wants things to be fair and just. That brings us to the command for the masters. For the employers here, he says, provide your slaves with what is right and fair. What does that mean? That's something you have to kind of look at God for. There's certain things that are legal. There's a legal minimum wage and things like that. Those things are legal. But God's standards are not always exactly in line with what's legal. What's the right thing to do to pay them? What's the right thing to give them? For them, in the first century, it was room, board, and something else, but various things. For us in our culture, you ought to think about what's the right thing to be paying them. What's the right working conditions to have for them? What's the right situation? Here's a person who has dignity. How should we treat them if you're an employer? Do you treat them with dignity, or do you treat them as utilities or things that you can discard at the end of the day when they cease to be useful to you? There's a reason why God wants employers to be righteous and fair. And that's because, masters, you too, you know that you also have a master in heaven. So you've got the employee, you've got the employer, but ultimately you've got the master in heaven. And one of the things that might help a master or a boss think about what's right and fair is to think, okay, this is how I'm paying, or this is how I'm treating my workers under me. How do I want my master in heaven to treat me? Recognize that? All of a sudden, this takes on a whole different world of application. If you're a boss, if you're a master, think about how you would want to be treated if your shoe was on the other foot, if you were in the other position. That's the golden rule. Jesus said, think about doing unto other people the way you would have them do to me, to you. A lot of application today, lots of things to think about. I'd like to share a video with you of somebody that puts the whole perspective of work in a different light. I think they might be able to communicate it even better than I am. One of the things you might want to do, if this is an issue that you're working on, is spend some time with a video series that we're going to show the trailer of right now. It comes from Right Now Media, if you'd share that with us.
Welcome to The Switch, the start of your Monday revolution. A switch in the way that you work. Thousands of others are making the switch with you. It's a switch to thriving, not just surviving on Mondays. Stress and discouragement affects millions of us on Mondays. Additionally, we have beliefs about work that cause us to switch off. None of us are immune. Each of us carries Monday baggage that keeps us from thriving like God desires. Things are about to change. Research reveals some shocking facts about Mondays. Listen to this. Studies show 50% of us show up late to work on Mondays. Productivity of the average worker is less than 30% on Mondays. Studies indicate that most don't even smile until 11:16 a.m. on Mondays, and people moan for over 10 minutes each Monday morning. Well, things get more troubling than this. Heart attacks increase by 20% on Mondays. And even more serious, Monday is the highest day for suicides. Plain and simple, the switch is a purposeful or unconscious act of switching God on or off while working. Here's a shocking truth about you and I. When you switch God off, you are actually participating in a form of practical atheism. Yes, atheism. Our attitudes and struggles with Mondays and work have a much deeper meaning and personal consequence than we ever realize. The Bible informs us that work is really a form of worship to God Himself. That's right, worship, just like a church. Whether working as a plumber, an executive, a parent, a nurse, a salesperson, whatever it is that you do, you can switch on. Ministry. Do you ever wonder what that really means? The word ministry simply comes from a root word, meaning to serve, as in serving God, your family, and your co-workers. Ministry happens wherever He is put, or wherever you find yourself. So any job done with God for His purpose is actual ministry. As a follower of Christ, your character, your source of power, and your work itself change because of the cross of Jesus. So being cross-wired means you can work from this position of power. It's who you really are. That's a transforming perspective to bring to work. With 52 Mondays a year, you will have frequent opportunities to switch God on Monday. Starting the week off right, empowered. Your work life will change. Your goal over these six sessions is to discover God's view of your work and to keep God switched on. Your Mondays will change and be more energetic and meaningful. So, hang on to your seats. Just up ahead is less moaning or grumbling and the ability to honestly say, thank God, it's Monday.
I hope you get the point of that, is that this is a resource that's available to you to continue your study in this topic. But the bigger application is that God is concerned about your whole life. He sent Jesus to die for you, who rose again, to save you from your sin, but ultimately to give you an abundant life. Every aspect brought under the lordship of Jesus Christ. And lived in light of His grace and mercy. That applies to work as well as everything else. I was reading this week, Paul the Apostle talked about the outcome of his preaching. And he said, I never stopped telling you to repent from sin and have faith in God. I thought every part of the Bible you can look at, repent of sin. Hey, if you've had been sleeping Monday through Friday at work, repent of that sin. If you can't figure out how to live work in light of God, that fits the second part. Have faith in God. Start with what I've shared already. Dig into this if you'd like to, and whatever it takes, so that work can be a form of worship for you. Would you join me in prayer? Father in heaven, I pray that you'll continue to move in our lives. Help us to accomplish all that you've got for us. Lord, I pray that out of this church, people will have such transformed lives, depending on you, living your grace, your mercy, that it can't help but transform our society. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.